afternoon or good morning, wherever, whichever time zone you may be in. First, I would like to start off in acknowledging that the University of Maryland is located on the traditional, ancestral, and contemporary lands of the Piscataway people. We acknowledge the painful history and legacies of genocide and forced displacement from this territory, and we pay our respect to the many diverse indigenous peoples still connected to this land on which we gather. And so welcome to the workshop segment of our annual Patterson Lecture here at the University of Maryland. And I would like to introduce our director of the Historic Preservation Program, Dennis Pogue.
Hello, everybody. Welcome. On behalf of the Historic Preservation Program, Dean Don Lionbaugh, and the entire School of Architecture Planning and Preservation, it's my pleasure to welcome you here to the second part of this year's annual Marvin Breckinridge Patterson Lecture. I got it out. The first part of the program was held last night, and it was recorded, by the way, and for those of you who did not participate, it will be available for viewing soon, so I recommend that to you. I think all of you who joined us for last night's panel will agree with me that the presentation was both powerful and evocative, and particularly timely as we continue to struggle with manifestations of systemic racism that continue to pervade society. In that regard, I also want to acknowledge the statement issued by the university administration just yesterday afternoon, which makes clear our solidarity with Asian and Asian American communities against the troubling surge in anti-Asian sentiment that has occurred over the last year. Finally, I want to express our thanks to the talented group of individuals in the School of Architecture, Planning, and Preservation in making this event happen. Fabian Gomez and TSC for his technical support, the communications team of Chris Inahosa, Yelena Dakovich and Maggie Haslam, who took care of all of the outreach and publicity, and Laura Stieg, administrative assistant who shepherded us to the finish line. We're almost there. It was Dr. Michelle McGollan who conceived of the program, contacted all of the players, and guided the process that led us here today. For the last 2 years, Michelle has been a presidential postdoctoral fellow with the HISP program, and her focus has been on increasing the role of underrepresented communities of color in historic preservation. If you missed the symposium that Dr. McGollan organized and which we held online in January, entitled Recentering the Margins, Justice and Equity in Historic Preservation, I recommend that you view those recorded proceedings as. I'll now turn it over to Michelle. Thanks.
Thanks, Dennis. So again, if you haven't had a chance to watch the lecture last night, we have it on our YouTube channel and we can share the link during today's discussion in our chat. Just some quick technical items. So you could see on the bottom of your Zoom screen, there is the chat option. So if you would like to share your questions there, you can do so after our speakers today give a brief overview on the material objects associated with the Eaton collection and the work that they're working on now. So you could do it in the chat and we could also open it up if you'd like to. This is a workshop, so you know, it's not a webinar. So if you aren't shy, you can still you can show yourself on the screen and then we'll ask you, you can ask your question live. Also, if I don't think we have closed captioning on here today, I apologize for that. But also, oh, there it is. If you want to and you're not able to, you know, if you would like to see the closed captioning, just click on, it says live transcript, the button that says CC, and you can follow along with the live captioning there. And also this workshop is being recorded and will be placed on our school's YouTube channel for future viewing. And so without further ado, I want to introduce two of our speakers. Shirley Ann Higuchi is unable to join us today, but we're able to have Nancy Ukai and Clement Hanami join us again. And so before they go into the presentation of their objects that they did a little teaser about last night, I'll just read their bios for you. So Nancy Ukai is project director for the website 50 Objects and Stories, the American Japanese Incarceration, which explores the material histories and genealogies of 50 concentration camp artifacts. It is supported by a National Park Service Japanese American Confinement Sites grant, 50objects.org. It's 50objects.org is their website. In 2015, she helped lead a social media protest to stop the Regal Arts auction of 450 camp objects that had been collected by Allen Eaton. The collection is now preserved at the Japanese American National Museum, where she is a consultant on researching the provenance. Nancy is a member of and an original organizer, co-organizer for Suru for Solidarity, a direct action project by Japanese American social justice advocates to protest migrant detentions and deportations. And then we also have Clement Hanami joining us, who is a Japanese American artist who grew up in the predominantly Latino California suburb of East Los Angeles. His mother was a Habakusha. Am I saying that right, Clement? Habakusha, or atomic bomb survivor. And his father was a World War II evacuee. He received his MFA from UCLA in studio art with a specialization in new genres, and his work has been exhibiting nationally, including recently Cross Lines, a culture lab on intersectionality at the Smithsonian Arts and Industries Building here in Washington, DC. Mr. Hanami is currently the Vice President of Exhibitions and Art Director at the Japanese American National Museum, and primarily responsible for the design, installation, fabrication, maintenance of the museum's major exhibits. He has a very long list of accolades, so you can visit our event page just so that we can spend more time, because it's very long, because he is very accomplished in his work. But he will be talking about the work at the Japanese American National Museum's project Contested Histories, which he gave you a very quick sneak peek last night. So without further ado, I wanted to invite Clement and Nancy, and I don't know which order if you would like to go in or just go back and forth, on some of the material objects that was part of the Eaton collection for the Ragu auction.
Nancy can go first.
Good morning, everybody. It's 9 o'clock here in Berkeley, California. Just thinking right offhand when, thank you, Michelle, for that introduction, is that the protest which led to the cancellation of the auction was all about voice, I think. The voice of descendants and survivors protesting the commodification and the sale of our cultural property and our heritage and our history. And it's also the voice that are in these artifacts, which is what we're trying to uncover now. It's very rewarding, and to have all of you here today is very special. So thank you for coming.
And then Nancy, would you like to start your presentation on the object?
Okay. Yeah. All right. So this morning, I want to thank the University of Maryland for inviting me to take part, the Japanese American National Museum, the National Park Service Japanese American Confinement Site Grant Program, Clement, David Izu, our art director, and also the descendants who have helped us identify the stories behind these artifacts, including Sharon Honda and Mitch Homma. So yesterday we talked about the context of the auction, the Japanese American imprisonment during World War II, and we talked about Estelle Ishigo, a Caucasian woman who was incarcerated at Heart Mountain, Wyoming, with her Japanese American husband. When they got married, they had to go to Mexico because interracial marriages were prohibited. So she's known for her artwork. She was hired by the WRA, the War Relocation Authority, to document visually what she saw while she was in prison at Heart Mountain, Wyoming. But I'm going to argue that her, and so her watercolors, her drawings, and her oil paintings were actually part of the things that were going to be auctioned off in the Rego auction in 2015. I'm going to argue today that there's another very important legacy, and that is her notebooks, her letters, and her records. So today we, yesterday we talked a bit about Allen Eaton and the 450 objects that were in his collection, which went on the auction block in 2015, or were scheduled to do so, and his book, which was published in 1952, Beauty Behind Barbed Wire, which was his record of the objects which he saw in the camps when he went to make a record and collect them in 1945 as the camps were closing. What's less known is the fact that Estelle Ishigo, who was at Heart Mountain, was his agent at in Wyoming and helped him collect things and also document who made them, and he would make requests to her. They were corresponding a great deal. I'm not exactly sure how they met, but it was probably through the director of Heart Mountain. And towards the end of their, he visited Heart Mountain, although it's not exactly clear what date it was. On October 1st, he wrote a letter to her and he said, "There's nothing more interesting in all the places I have been than the work of the artists and craftsmen which you have uncovered for me." So here is a photograph of Estelle at Heart Mountain with a dog. She had pets. And she said in her personal records later that she worked for Eaton between July and October of 1945. And she said she did written reports, photos, and collection of handcrafts for Allen Eaton, who was working for the Sage Foundation in New York City. This is the badge that she had as a hired artist for the WRA. So today I'm going to talk about three things that briefly that she had a hand in helping him acquire. The first is nameplates. There were two lots of nameplates, and they came from different camps, including the Amachi camp in Colorado, but also Heart Mountain. And Mineo Kubo wrote in her book, Citizen 13660, that the residential blocks all looked alike. People were lost all the time. And one of the things people did early on was to start right from the assembly centers in spring of 42, started to make nameplates. And these could be elaborate, they could be simple, but they were hung on the outside for visitors, for the mail delivery, and I believe also just to assert agency. I'm not a number, say my name. So one of the letters that Eaton wrote to Ishigo was, "With the approval of Director Robertson, please collect a dozen more or less of the most important nameplates to be found on the barracks. I think it would be nice to have this collection from Heart Mountain." He also did the same thing in Colorado at the Grenada or Amachi camp. So in the after the auction was canceled and the Japanese American National Museum acquired the collection, this particular nameplate caught my eye because it has this naturalistic feel to it. It has the name of the person in Roman, in Western letters, S. Imura, but also in kanji. It kind of seems to convey the sense of Japanese wabi-sabi, allowing the wood to have its natural form, which precedes the work of George Nakashima. So where is this nameplate? It's in lot 1247 in a group that's kind of thrown together. And in order to find out which camp he might have been in, I went to the National Archives online, and of 110,000 files at the National Archives, there are 30 with the name Imura, and they were in four camps, in Tule Lake, California, Gila River, Arizona, Jerome, Arkansas, and Heart Mountain, Wyoming. So he could have been, you know, presumably in any of these four camps. But what was really crucial was finding in Estelle Ishigo's papers at the UCLA Library of Special Collections was this very humble, small notebook, the kind you would hold in your hand. And on one of the pages, it said Imura, 1220, Alameda House, get smoked boards. And you can see in this notebook that she's busily running around helping Eaton get stuff, because underneath it, it says Toyota, block 1722. He's getting a carving. and so on and so forth. So back to the National Archives. I pulled Imura's, somebody who I thought might be the Imura that Estelle Ishigo referenced in her notebook. And that's her handwriting, of course. And so at the National Archives, Imura Sakanosuke, and that's an S, so pretty good, so good, so far so good. He's at Heart Mountain, and wow, he's in Block 12, Barrack 20 in Unit E, which matches, of course, Estelle Ishigo's notes. And furthermore, he was in Alameda, California, and she's talking about how something about Alameda House, where he was from 1930 to 1942 before he was incarcerated. So that was really exciting to see that her notes led to identifying him. So who was Mr. Imura? He was born in Issei. He was born in Ehime Prefecture in 1877. He arrived in the United States as a student when he was 22 years old in 1899 in Seattle. However, by just before the war, he was the owner of this extremely large hotel known as the Kashu Hotel on Laguna and Sutter Street in San Francisco's Japantown. He had two sons, three daughters. He had a condition. At Heart Mountain, he was working for the coal crew. So further in his National Archive file, I found this telegram, and it was sent to Henry Stimson, the head of the War Department. And he said, "I'm father of soldier William Taizo Imura of the US Army. I've been sick since March 1945 of heart disease. The WRA director here, Robertson, is trying to forcibly make me leave on October 12th. So that's 2 days after this Western Union telegram was sent. My plans are to leave early in November when my own home will be available. I need your help and protection, Sakanosuke Imura." So that was really surprising to find that telegram, and also to see that he sent it to President Truman. I mean, he really exerted himself and was really a pretty kick-ass guy. I thought, I was surprised. So also in the file was this memo to Dylan S. Meyer, the director of the War Relocation Authority, the following day after the telegram was received. And on the right-hand side in pencil says, "Handled by telephone by Dylan S. Meyer, the director of the WRA, and Mr. Imura got permission to leave on his own terms." And so this is a photograph of him here in the front. It was given, shared with us by a family member, Sharon Imura Honda. And this is Sharon, who is the granddaughter of Mr. Imura, and her father Haruo was one of Sakonosuke's sons. So I thought that nameplate led us to a really fascinating story that otherwise might have been buried. So I just want to say that objects are gateways into the personal stories, but in addition to preserving the physical items, it's so important to look at the related sources if they're available, such as Estelle's diaries and notebooks, which provide invaluable clues to the life circumstances of those connected to the artifact. And her small notebook really allows us to understand a past time and its materiality. And what really struck me was that you don't know what will be important to historians or curious researchers like me 70 years later, because this kind of notebook is the kind of thing that you might just say, "What's this?" and throw it away. But how happy and, you know, lucky we are that it's preserved at the UCLA Archives. Just a footnote is that in his loyalty questionnaire, Mr. Imura mentioned F. Mihara as a reference, who is in another block, and they've known each other for 40 years. And it turns out that the Miharas are the grandparents of Sam Mihara. So some of you may know Sam. He's in Nisei. He lives in Southern California. He's a national speaker on the incarceration. And so these are the kinds of connections that are enabled by doing this research, which is extremely, I find, rewarding. The second object I'd like to cover briefly is another very important, almost, I would say, iconic object in the auction, and that is this, what Rego Auction House called a camp dining chair. It was one of six dining room chairs, and this photograph is also in the now Janum collection, and it was taken in New York City And in Eaton's own handwriting on the back of the photograph, it says one of six dining room chairs built from salvaged materials at Heart Mountain Relocation Center. Interestingly, it's not shown in Beauty Behind Barbed Wire. So not everything that was on sale by any means was documented in the book. So interestingly, Estelle Ishigo in 1942 documented or drew a charcoal of people making their own furniture and getting salvaged wood to make things for their empty barracks. And I think what's very interesting about this particular chair is the way that whoever made it left the natural opening in the back as a feature, because many people would just view this as a flaw and throw it away. But I think that gave it a sense of a distinguishing characteristic and a sense of Japanese aesthetics that this particular person had. So let's go to the letters, which are preserved in the UCLA archives. Allen Eaton wrote to Ishigo on October 14th. Did Mr. Homma, he had gone to Heart Mountain, he apparently had seen this chair and he fell in love with it. Did Mr. Homma leave one of his chairs, the one I wanted photographed, and told him I would be glad to buy if he took them, meaning people were leaving the camps, it's 1945. If he took them wherever he went back, we can probably have at least photographed in their new location. And then about a week later, he writes, referring first to the letter, I'm glad you got Mr. Homma's chair. So again, we have confirmation that, the Homma, we now know a name, Homma, and we also know that Estelle Ishigo was critical in helping him acquire it. So thanks to actually a very serendipitous meeting that I had with Mitch Homma at a Chinese restaurant in Northern California, we connected the dots. And he didn't know that his ancestor's chair was in the auction. And I was so delighted to find that he actually has an amazing archive of his own, a family history. He was able to provide photographs of Yorozu Homma, his grand uncle, who had come to the United States as a young man to study greenhouse technology because his family in Shizuoka had a lot of land which they were developing, wanted to make it more productive. Mitch shared with us these 1932 photographs, probably in Los Angeles, of Yorozu with his wife Shige. And then after the war, they returned to Japan. So this photograph is of them in 1958. What's wonderful too is that Mitch shared with us a photograph of the maker of the chair's family in Shizuoka. This seems to be possibly a New Year's photograph. So Yorozu's parents were in Shizuoka in the middle, and then his three sisters are shown. The man on the left, I think, is a brother-in-law. Yorozu had already been in the United States for 20 years by this time, and I thought, oh, they're sitting on chairs. They had a traditional, beautiful Japanese house in Shizuoka. But if you'd like to know more about this story, we cover it in object number 2 in our project. And then Mitch also shared with us the grandson, a photograph of the grandson and great-grandson of Yorozu. And so the family stories and the ability to reconnect back with Japan is also, I think, very special that this artifact has enabled. Finally, I'm going to just talk a little bit about the third artifact, a very important one that was rescued in the Rego auction. And this is a painting by Estelle Ishigo herself. It's an oil painting. It's 20 by 24 inches, and the title is Segregation. So in the auction, there were several lots of her watercolors and then two oil paintings, which are on the left, one of a swimming hole and the second one of Segregation. So this painting, what does it represent? I mean, it says segregation. What exactly does that mean? It turns out that in doing research, I happened to see, and or just knowing, being familiar with what's out there, I saw this photograph in a book about Bill Mambo's color photography that was edited by that was edited, and this photograph showed the exact same day. In fact, I almost wondered if Estelle Ishigo had used it as a basis for her paintings. But it turns out that they were both taken, the painting and the photograph were made on September 21st, 1943. And it shows several hundred people waiting to get on the train to be segregated to the Tule Lake Segregation Center because they were being accused of being disloyal to the United States. They had answered this questionnaire, questions number 27 and number 28, in a way that the government deemed improper, and they were therefore being taken away from Heart Mountain. And it was a very important day. It was one of a few days when the community was being ripped apart. So present this art, this news article from the time shows you that President Roosevelt informed the Senate today that the War Relocation Authority began early this month to segregate from the 95,000 persons in Japanese relocation centers those who had indicated loyalty to Japan. And the first train movements have already begun. So this painting actually was depicting that movement from the Heart Mountain camp. They were from all of the camps, all of the 10 camps, people were being removed to Tule Lake. And so the first group was going to comprise about 6,300. And in Heart Mountain, the Heart Mountain Sentinel newspaper from the following issue said that 431 segregees were being sent off to Tule Lake. And it was very interesting to me to see that the reporter who wrote this article said they were saying farewell. Well-wishers braved a lowering sky and threats of wind and rain to say farewell to former residents who have chosen to be Japanese rather than Americans. And it later said they wish to be American, that is the people who stayed behind. So you can see this propagandistic perspective in the newspaper article, which is casting the people who were resisting their own incarceration as being disloyal to the United States. And in the same Heart Mountain Sentinel newspaper, there's a very poignant section, not on the front page here, but on the internal pages, where people have taken out advertisements and they're saying farewell. And one of them says, to our friends and neighbors, we wish to express our sincerest gratitude for the kindnesses and courtesies extended to us during our residence in Heart Mountain. May we take this means to bid you farewell as we have left for Tule Lake. So people would have already been gone by the time this Heart Mountain newspaper had been published. But that Bill Mambo photograph, Estelle Ishigo's painting, really capture the gravity, the historic moment, the tragic circumstances of Heart Mountain at that time. Bill Mambo was known for taking quote unquote non-political photographs. That one was obviously a very important day for him. So Estelle is a WRA employee. She's paid $19 a month to make these visual reports. They are the property of the US government. So the question for us is, how did this segregation painting end up in Eaton's hands and for sale 72 years after it was made? Again, going back to the archives, in 1948, so 3 years after she was released, she was still living in a trailer camp. She was trying to locate her works, and she wrote to the War Relocation Authority, I wish to inquire about paintings that I did during my stay at the Heart Mountain Camp. I would like to know where the paintings are, may now be found, or what disposal may have been made. And then she specifically mentions the oil painting segregation. These are paintings made for the reports division at Heart Mountain, Wyoming. So that is a mystery for us to think about. How did Eaton end up with this? She was trying to reestablish herself. She was trying to paint. She was trying to gather her work from that period of time. And that's something that I'm continuing to look at. And I think it's important to understand how what we call the Eaton collection is comprised of things that were made by the prisoners. And here she is trying to reacquire her work, and which was actually considered one of the most important objects for sale in the Eaton auction. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Nancy. And I, as we turn over to Clement, if folks do have questions, first of all, I invite you to put it in the chat, and then we'll do questions after Clement's presentation. But I would like to hand it off over to Clement.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Nancy. Great job, as always. Nancy has hundreds of these stories. She's done so much work, but she can only tell so much in a very limited amount of time. So I'm always, every time I watch her, I learn something new. So thank you. I'm going to speak a little bit, you know, we're doing very similar work. And so in the workshop portion, we're going to be doing a lot of this storytelling. And I just feel like it's a really good time to mention the fact that a lot of this work, the bulk of this work has been funded by the National Park Service, the Japanese American Confinement Site grants. And so, you know, because of their support, we're able to do this very important work. Of the national parks, I think there's five of them are sites of conscience like this, like Japanese American concentration camps. I think Bainbridge Island is one of them, which was a debarkation point of camp. And so it's just good to mention that. I also noticed that sometimes we talk about the word concentration camps, and you know, we use the words inmates and incarceration. And it's to acknowledge the fact that, you know, it's really to honor those people that were in camp, because, you know, the government used a lot of euphemisms, relocation centers, assembly centers. But really, these people were put into prisons for the duration of the war. And so we just like to use that that terminology. As we what I'm going to show today right now is sort of the process of how a museum takes this collection on the road. Yesterday in the workshop, we talked about how, you know, we wanted to crowdsource this. We wanted to take this artifacts to the people, because we realized, again, a lot of the people who might know anything about this would be older, elderly, and that it wouldn't be easy for them to travel from Washington State or Chicago or Washington, D.C. to Los Angeles. So it was imperative that we go there and bring this collection to them. And so this is just a short video of one of the first trips they made, which eventually ended up being 50. Hello. Arale. 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 Arale.
Reached the halfway point. We're gonna stop and have breakfast and fill up, and then we'll be in San Francisco.
I guess I should cut it.
Because you have tried to come back.
Hello.
there a ramp down there?
A what?
Is there a ramp? I'm going to follow you guys.
That's Matt and Jennifer, and they work at the Japanese Cultural and Community Center of Northern California, which serves close to 200,000 annually through programs, events, and facilities use. The JCCCNC is owned and operated by the community, and they work to preserve and promote Japanese and Japanese American culture, heritage, and community.
Seek food, the rich seek an appetite. So when a rabbit's like you looking straight at the light, at the end of the tunnel you see we've been there. They give you what's in, we give you what's instead. Heat up the truth and serve it to you in an instant. So hot it left a permanent imprint. Whether we rhyming or we marching in another rally, from Seattle to the Bay down to Southern Cal. Summer hot, summer hot, no manga, ba ba ba. I'm layer, I knew my lava, fire, soft. Overseas to where we be. Three bullets in the belly, Geobam and Kiwi. We like practice and theory. Put us together to get the message more clearly. More than merely rap, and this is activism. To unite the blind and get them back to the
treasure.
So that gentleman that was sitting at the table there was that was actually JT Sata's grandson, and he identified one of the photographs in our collection. And so we've been able to since interview him and the grandson and the son to talk about JT Sata and his work. This is another story. This is a nameplate that we found in the collection. This is the nameplate that we were able to translate to Naokichi Hashizume. And so we were able to find him in our camp database, the camp database from the National Archives. And it's a great record. It's one of the key records that a lot of us use to track down people and identify people. And then once we found out that Naokichi, the name, we can confirm the name, we actually found that he's in our collection. And so we found this is some footage of that Naokichi took at Hard Mountain. And we actually have a very large collection of his films. And so it's interesting because it really depicts how they really wanted to just live normal lives. They wanted to document it. So here they're having tea, you know, if you can imagine being in camp. So, you know, that's a great way for us to really understand the benefit of our collection, because we can connect it with we can connect it with an existing archive of information and data. We continue to research, and we find that, you know, Naokichi actually did he wanted to be naturalized. And so I was looking at his record, and I noticed that his address was 2046 Federal Avenue. And so, like Nancy says, you know, we're always looking for clues. We're always trying to find more information. And so I know someone who actually lives on 2045 Federal, and it's Eric Nakamura of Giant Robot Magazine. And so I start to text him going like, hey, do you know Hashizume? It's a pretty unusual name. And texts go back and forth. You know, he's very kind of elusive. And then next thing you know, on my phone, this picture shows up. And I go, where did you get this picture? And he goes, oh, my friend, Kevin. I grew up with Kevin. He now lives in Portland. But Naokichi has passed away, but Kevin is still alive. And I think, okay, that's great. I want to meet Kevin. And so when we took the collection to Portland, Oregon, I put an email into Kevin so that he could come see the artifact. And but he had a surprise for me, which you'll see in the...
right here. Recognize the name.
Can you read that?
Hashizu Minaokichi.
You can read Japanese?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Well, a little bit. The name I can read. But other than that, I can't.
What are some of the things that that you guys have at home of his?
Oh, a lot of carvings. He did a lot of carvings. He learned to carve in camp.
Huh.
Yeah.
And he carved afterwards?
Hmm?
And
he carved a little bit afterwards, yeah. But, he took a lot of pictures. He really loved taking pictures. Well, he was in camp. Everybody had to do some work. So he worked on the railroad for a little while. Did a bunch of went to work on the railroad. Then he worked as a policeman for a while. Then he worked as a cook for a while. He did all kinds of, odd jobs there in camp. But he had a camera that he smuggled in, if you want to call it. Yeah, and friends would send him film, from outside. And he'd take the movies, and I guess he'd send it to Sears and have it developed, and it's in the back. Yeah. And so he took quite a few movies. And so we were able to develop a lot of the movies. We were all young yet, and we all played and stuff together. It was a good time for the kids and the parents, in the sense that the parents didn't have to watch the kids because they couldn't get into trouble. You're confined in one area, and the kids could run around and do whatever they want, and the parents didn't have to worry about them. And I think it was a hardship for the parents because they lost everything. But then again, everybody made do with what, they made the best of everything. Yeah. I think he'd be real honored to have something that he did show up in his head. But, it's nice for people to be able to see all this. So it's good that there is a way to save all this and preserve it.
Okay, sorry, my buttons are a little bit off, but yeah, so that was actually Kevin at the end. So I didn't know his father was even alive. So when he brought him, it was quite jarring. It was actually great. We were doing a presentation and then they walked in and I said, "Who's that guy?" He goes like, "That's my dad." Oh, and so it was great to be able to then talk to them, interview them, just talk about their memories and add to the layers of this history, to know that there are survivors and people who have recollections and can help us to better contextualize. Again, when you think about this collection, it came to us with nothing except the book. It was quite daunting. It just came in boxes, cardboard boxes. So literally from scratch, just, a good thing the names are there. We can start with the names, but even then, like Nancy said, there's like 50, satos or something. How do you then narrow it down? You start to look at the materials of the wood. Was this wood available in Heart Mountain, or could you get, this definitely looks like something that would have come from the southeast, like in Arkansas or something. So it's quite challenging and always rewarding when you get those moments like that. This is another piece. This piece actually does exist. It's in the collection. But we weren't sure who made it, but luckily it was featured in the book. So Eaton writes about it here, and he puts the name Kakumen Tsurioka. We looked that up in the database, it doesn't show up. So we're thinking like, who is this person? Eaton wrote the name in there. So then, he talks about the Mojave room. So we start to look at newspapers, microfilm, and we find that he does mention Mr. Tsurioka. Okay, so there's a typo. He misspells his name. Story of my life. our names are, Japanese names are often misspelled or mispronounced So it's good that we can figure these things out. But, then we start to look in the database. It's still not in the database. So then we Google it and we find out that there's another person named Kakunen Tsurioka who is actually a pen name. His real name is Tokutaru Tsurioka. And then so we're able to go into the database and check that. And then that is where we find, sorry, the actual records with his real name is Tokutaro Tsuroka. And he was a trade, you know, he would go to Japan and bring stuff back to sell in America. He was actually quite successful at this in the Bay Area. He was an agent for people like John Dewey. And so with that, we're able to then look more earnestly into our collection. And then we find that we actually have paintings of his under the pen name Kakunen Tsuruoka. And you can see the connections between this inlay that he had designed and some of his paintings from Poston, Arizona. So it's just an example of, again, you're looking for any kind of clue and you're using every resource available as far as databases to find the stories. Here's a story that we were able to capture in San Francisco. And I attribute a lot of this stuff. Again, it's the work of Nancy who helps us connect with people. So when we went to JSA, which is a senior organization in Emeryville, East Bay, east of San Francisco, we were able to connect with her. And the interview that you're going to see here is actually one that was done with June Burke. I think June Burke's on this call too. You know, she's been a great resource, again, using as many of our resources to capture these stories. So here she talks a little bit about this photograph.
My mother was an artist, a painter, and designer, so she did do a watercolor of our barracks when we were at the assembly center. She said she wanted to record it exactly as it looked. So there's a picture of me. I'm lying on the bed on my stomach drawing a picture or something. There's also a picture of my mother and I in the... at Amachi in the room there that she shared with my aunt. The three of us were in the same room. Because she was an artist, she wanted to fix her room up nice. So she and her friends would go to the wood pile and take things, and they built their own furniture, built the table, and then made the windows look like shoji screens by spraying it with the artificial snow type stuff and dividing it into little wood strips to make it look like shoji. And when this picture was also printed in a book titled Beauty Behind Barbed Wire, and it was also, the subject was about art produced in the camps. And this picture was also printed in the local paper at the time, it was in Colorado. And I heard that there was somebody who wrote a letter to the newspaper because complaining that they were coddling the Japs because the room looked too nice. But little did they know that it was my mother who made it look nice. I do remember seeing pictures published in the papers and of that period, and that emotionally, even though I didn't remember specifically things, that it did bring up feelings seeing the soldiers with bayonets standing, you know, herding people into buses and into the trains. Then I remember kind of feeling that fear or a little confusion, not knowing what was happening, what was going on. I think because of the fact that she would have been in her 20s still. At that age, they still had hopes of a life after camp. She seemed to have a pretty optimistic spirit about her, and when she talked to me about it, well, she would say things like, "Oh, we young people, we had a good time. And because they did have activities in camp, and they were Japanese seemed to be really good at organizing like social activities, the dances and things for young people to do. And maybe she was, you know, just trying to be reassuring to me. You know, I can understand what that must have been really difficult for people my grandparents' age, you know, after they had worked so hard all their lives and finally being able to find some kind of security in their life, having it all taken away from them. And if you're 50, 60 and have to start all over again, that must have been very difficult. So I really give so much respect and credit to people like my grandfather.
The buttons are really fast for me, sorry. And so this is the last set of slides I'll show. I know Nancy had mentioned, she covered very well the segregation, the loyalty questionnaire, how after all Japanese Americans were put into camp in the beginning of 1943, they did issue a loyalty questionnaire to all, initially all males and then to everybody eventually. And there were two controversial questions in there, 27 and 28, that talked about one, if you would, you know, promise your allegiance to and promise, you know, swear to up, what was it, to defend the United States and to be willing to fight in any war in any location, and then the second one was to forswear any allegiance to Japan. And so I think if you were to ask people that question, most people would say, sure, of course we would do that. But the context was, Japanese Americans were told to, you know, sell all their belongings in a week's time, to liquidate all of their lives, and then go into prison camps. And then once in these prison camps, they were asked these questions, you know, and there was so much confusion for people because people, you know, some people said yes, but people said, wait, we don't have any rights. What happened? We're in jail now. Why couldn't they have asked us before? You know, there was just utter confusion in all the camps. And Tule Lake was probably one of the most hard hit because they didn't get the questionnaires until very late. People had to fill these out like in a very short amount of time. And Tule Lake would eventually become the segregation camp. So this is a picture of it. And if you look very closely here, you know, this camp would eventually have a stockade created. There was a jail created, a jail within a jail, a concrete, like the craziest, you know, like a federal prison. Like, it's just amazing. Even today, they can't tear it down because it's so built so well. But this camp, you know, most camps had maybe about 9 guard towers. This one has over 30. Over the whole camp, because this became a high security camp, and its highest point, it had almost 19,000 people. And so a lot of the Issei, who were very, you know, confused and didn't know what to do, ended up here. And, you know, but there's also stories of women whose husbands were already taken to high security camps, didn't know what to do. So they would just follow their parents. And so because they had young children, they had nowhere, you know, they would just went with their grandparents. So again, the story of Tule Lake is not simple. It's very complex. And so there's a link to the tulelake.org site, and they're doing a great job of trying to preserve that history and share it with as many people as possible, because in, you know, a long time ago, it was a stigma to say you were at Tule Lake, but now we're finding that it really was an unfortunate story that encompasses all the experiences of the camp. So like Nancy had mentioned, it affected everybody, because everybody was sent from all different camps who might have answered no to any of the questions, and we're all sent to here. So it affected every camp. And then people who said yes, yes, at Tule Lake were sent to these other camps. So in that context, there's this group of people. This is a photograph from the Eaton collection. And it's a picture of a yosegaki, which is a cloth that people will sign as a commemoration of an event. So this is a gathering of a senju poetry club. Senju is like haiku, but haiku is more about nature and beauty. And senju is more about life and satire and irony, kind of like Seinfeld. And so the thoughts and the writings are much more deep and talk about life in general. It was done in 1945. So again, this is after, about a year after segregation. The name of the group is The Raft. They call it The Raft. And my translator tells me that, you know, it's a symbolic of sort of this group of people who are like in the ocean and they're just stuck. They don't know where they're going. They're not a boat. They're just a raft floating. And if you look at the description that Eaton has, he just says it's a collection of autographs. But clearly we know that it's much more than that. It's the personal thoughts of these people. And so these are just some of the translations. They're very hard to translate. This is written in very, during the Meiji period, these people would have been educated. It's very hard to read the calligraphy. So this is the best translations that we have from our translator. And so this one illustrates sort of the hope that people still have, that their things will get better, that they will persevere, they will get through this, you know, with their belief in God. And it's interesting because some of the Eaton translations we have some Eaton calligraphy that was done from the Eaton collection. And it's when I got the translations back, it was like, oh, this is the King James Bible written in Japanese calligraphy. So it's interesting how you never know what it really is until you translate it. Okay. This is another poem. I stare at my shadow and walk. I've grown tired of the fence. And so when you just think about, you know, an individual who has gone through this whole process, now lamenting, staring at his shadow, which is really just an empty silhouette of the person, talking about walking in basically in circles around a camp. So this is, again, at Tule Lake, which is now a segregation center. And then the last one that we have translated is, before I knew it, I've raised the child of a person of the enemy state. This idea that, you know, these 2/3 of the people that were incarcerated were American-born Japanese Americans. And to see the sort of the struggles that the families have to go through and realize they all wanted to, everyone for the most part wanted to be American. They came to America because they felt they were going to make their lives in America. And then to just write about this in poetry, I think is very enlightening and illustrating. Because a lot of times we pigeonhole the first generation as being, you know, only Japanese speaking and not knowing, you know, just being like the older generation. So, but it really does illustrate sort of the compassion and the feelings that they had during this tumultuous time. Okay, and so that I'm going to stop there, but that's just an example of some of the work that we're doing on many layers. I think the pandemic has been hard, but you know, I think we still continue to dig deep. And I think like Nancy, you know, our goal really is to be storytellers, because I think it's important that we make this accessible to people. You know, that we reveal the personal sides of this experience. So, thank you.
Thanks, Clement. And so we're going to open it up to questions. I know there was some specific questions asked in the chat. Hopefully I shared the correct link, but I don't know if Clement, because this was one year presentation, Paula Fujiwara was asking if the exact link in NARA records that you used, are these digitized or are they still in the College Park location that you had to go to?
I mean, the AAD archives.gov is a good link. That should get you right to the camp databases.
And it's all digitized?
It's not photographs, it's digital. Yeah, it's
okay.
It's been entered into a database. If you go to ancestry.com though, there's still a lot of JPEGs that you could download, you know, you can see the actual documents.
Yeah. Great. So I'm gonna open it up if anyone would like to, and it's a good size of a group, so you don't have to be shy if you want to ask your question live. It's great. And so any questions from the audience? And I also want to note, this is I've been fortunate, like I went to Contested Histories over in Seabrook, New Jersey two summers ago at the Seabrook Obon, and got to see people, how they connected with the objects and even the people just connecting with each other at these kinds of events. And so I kind of even just want to acknowledge even at this virtual event, you know, to have George Nakai, who was incarcerated in Amachi, to be here with us today. And then, Mitch is like, his family's from Amachi. So trying to connect Mitch and George, so hopefully they get a chance to talk about their the work that's happening in Amachi as part of the National Park Service work. I think it's a wonderful kind of just like how these opportunities and these kind of just intersections and connections happen. So I wanted to just even ask that question of, and I think it's great, Clement, you document these like by video. Are there other like kind of instances that you can speak of where even these objects have brought people together? And I think, Clement, you brought it up more so, but like even now in time of COVID, right, as we've had to pivot a lot more online in the last year, how has probably your approach in programming brought people who may not have been able to go to the in-person workshops?
I think as soon as the pandemic hit, we knew we had to go digital. And so in April, we started to do these programs on YouTube Live. And thanks to Nancy, she did one all by herself as well. And again, just trying to raise awareness. And, we've created a digital, if you go to our website, Contested Histories exhibition website, there's a link to the Flickr page where you can see every image that's part of the collection, as well as there's a Google form that you could click and enter information. Been trying to encourage, as much intergenerational activity as possible, because we know that getting seniors online is not as easy as 1, 2, 3. It's sometimes, it's hardware issues, software issues, clicking issues, vision issues. So there's a lot of challenges. And so as much as possible, young people who have parents that can, help them, guide them through. We have it broken into sections, camps, so that you can focus your search. But there's so many opportunities for people to connect. And we're not just looking for, like, it doesn't have to be an exact, that's my nameplate. It could just be stories that people really connect with. I mean, we've had stories of just people who remember seeing Eleanor Roosevelt when she visited the camps and recall their experiences. To us, those are all valuable and help to fill the sort of the micro stories of this experience I know you had mentioned earlier the Eaton collection. When we showed these videos, some people were asking, like, well, when you find these people, do you give them the nameplate back? And I get that question everywhere I go. It's a funny question. And I have to say, unfortunately not. But I promise them that this will be something that we will take care of in posterity, and that one of the goals of our museum is really to make these things accessible to people. So people can email us, they can tell us when they're coming, and we will bring the collections out to people to look at so that they can know that their family collection is still accessible and available. But that we want to make sure that that object has their family story next to it. So, I mean, I think that's the important, that whole ideal of the Eaton collection, you know, like, why do we call it that? For me, it's part of the meta story, you know, because I think it is controversial. But if we were to cancel the name or something, you might lose that story for future generations, right? 100 years from now, people would say, oh, it's just the Japanese American National Museum collection. No, this is the Eaton. Why is the, who's Eaton, you know? Oh, well, there was this backstory of how this came here. I mean, Eaton had all the right intentions. He just wasn't very good at bookkeeping or keeping records. And there were some unfortunate steps that he took. But I am oftentimes grateful the fact that this collection does exist. We know that through Nancy's research, though, that this is not the whole collection. That through the years, there are missing pieces. There were things that... We have pictures from like Heart Mountain that, again, Hattie Strum had taken for Estelle Ishigo that show an array of nameplates, but they're not in the collection because at some point somebody took them, or, you know, maybe Eaton's family friends came and said, oh, that's a nice bird pin. And then, you know, they may have just taken it. It's unfortunate, but it's the reality of the situation. So.
I'd just like to add to Clement's extremely textured and comprehensive sort of overview of this collection is this kind of research is exactly what we wanted David Rago to do, or to allow us to do, before these things were sold to the highest bidder and disappeared into private hands. What we were saying was, just because you possess this, or somebody possesses it, a corporate businessman in Connecticut possesses it, doesn't mean you get to sell it. If you go to a garage sale and you find a painting that is, say, let's just say it's a Picasso, it doesn't mean that you now own it and get to sell it. And we were saying, what is the provenance? You know, and for us as a community, what are the stories here? How did he meet people? How did he acquire things? Did he buy them? Did he take them off barracks after people had already left? These are, again, the stories of displacement, of people leaving things behind when they'd already had left so much or lost so much before that. So so I think that this kind of research is very healing. It's rewarding. And it's also important so that the Eaton collection is up for sale to the highest bidder. We recognize that these things represent people and communities. And just as the collection has been dispersed, it represents dispersed people. By doing the research, we're able to bring the stories and the community back together. So it really is like getting puzzle pieces and saying, oh, these match. Oh, these people knew each other. Oh, even now, the guy who is near Giant Robot knows Kevin, who knows so-and-so, who brings some people back. So I think that's really important.
Thanks, Nancy. I know I see Laura's hand, and then I have two questions in the chat. So Laura, would you like to ask your question?
Sure. And forgive my ignorance on the topic, but I was wondering if you could speak to sort of the built environment of these camps and these objects, and has there been an effort to sort of put the objects back into the places that where they I guess were made or started. I'm just thinking for our preservation students, you know, if they're working in a house somewhere and they find objects that are tied to the house, how would you kind of advise them?
I think Clement, you should.
That's a tricky question, but like there is, I mean, we have so many stories that we've captured, but there is one that I'm reminded of, like that then Nancy's worked on with her name is Sharon Fukushima. I'm trying to remember her father's name is Takashi, but I can't remember the nameplate from Arkansas.
It'll come to me.
showing our age here, but you know, that is a story that we captured, and you know, she brought the nameplate to the museum, and then she wanted to donate it right there, and I said, we definitely want this, but I don't want to make it feel like you have to donate it to us because we're documenting your story. I see what happened to your family, you know. The Fukushima family came all the way to Arkansas to sort of, the young children came with the parents to experience what the camps were about. And for me, that nameplate illustrated this ability to bring the family together. So I felt I did not want to take it from, I wanted them to at least experience it in their own families for a decade or, you know, I said, we're always here. We'll take it when you're ready. But right now there's so much magic to me, at least happening in your family, that I want that to happen. I want it to stay with you for now. If I do an exhibition, I'm going to borrow it from you because I do feel like power of place is important. And so yesterday we did talk about the Heart Mountain, the Estelle Ishigo paintings, and sort of in our work, often felt, you know, there was so much collaboration amongst all the players. In that situation, you know, we're currently in the third year of a short-term loan because most museums' bylaws don't allow for loans longer than 12 months. So this is not being recorded, right? For any records. But it is something that, you know, again, that's an example of how a museum can respond to a community and allow Heart Mountain, where Estelle Ishigo lived, to exhibit the works, as long as we are working in collaboration, ensuring that the storage is proper, light controls are met, and that it can last for generations, because that is our goal with our collection, is not just to preserve it for my lifetime or the children's lifetime, but for their great-great-great-grandchildren's lifetimes. So these stories can continue to be told.
I think also some of the camps, you know, have no interpretive center or no physical place to preserve these things. For example, two that were built on Indian reservation land, native land, are not accessible, in fact, to descendants, except in the case of Gila River, where you can apply to see it. And so it's important to recreate these stories, but it's not necessarily the case that it's always possible to return the artifacts to the place where they originated. But on the other hand, because there are, for example, National Park Service sites like Tule Lake, which is, you know, going to be building an interpretive center someday, or the Manzanar site, of course, and Minidoka. And then there are private camps, such as, of course, Heart Mountain and Topaz in Wyoming and Utah. Eventually, perhaps there will be a pilgrimage trail where you can visit all of the different campsites and either honor that period and remember it through just visiting the land and seeing maybe some sort of monument, but also museums and historical centers.
Thank you. There's a lot of questions in the chat. Hopefully I can, I know some folks are answering some of the questions, but I know I'm scrolling back. So one of the questions was regarding Estelle Ishigo, which, you know, she acted as a go-between, right? Between Eaton and being inside the camp. And also very interesting, she was a white woman married to a Japanese American, right? So I was even intrigued because she got an allowance, right, for her work. And so even negotiating race and identity, you know, and kind of that go-between. So I don't know if you want, if Nancy, if you would like to just kind of talk about that, of her role, and were there others like Estelle that were these go-betweens, you know, with Eaton, or was she the only one?
He definitely was working with Toyo Miyatake, the photographer, and Iwasaki, the photographer. He was definitely working with administration officials. And although he opposed the incarceration, he was really very political. So he had relationships with Dylan Meyer and was able to use those to get into the camps, to get permission, to work with people, to, you know, get around. And so did he have other, I don't think he had anybody to the extent who worked with him as closely to the extent of Estelle Ishigo. And if you go to the UCLA archives, it's fascinating to see the correspondence. Sometimes he wrote to her more than one time a day, and some of them are handwritten and they're single space typed letters. And it's extremely specific about, did you check into that flower arranging piece? Did you get to talk to that photographer? You're going to go to a professional photographer in Cody to get these items photographed. And so at that time, it was a very intensive relationship in correspondence. But what's poignant is that afterwards, you know, she went into a trailer camp with total poverty for several years, and their correspondence dropped off. And by the time his book is published in 1952, 10 years later, she's not mentioned in the acknowledgments. And then he did use one of her paintings as one of the artifacts, the over 90 artifacts he featured in Beauty Behind Barbed Wire. But it was, I thought, rather perfunctory. It was like a paragraph that described her work, but you did not get a sense of the depth of her help to him.
And how is it that UCLA Special Collections has her works, her correspondences?
That's a good question. I should know this, and I think I did at one point. But she donated this. Yeah. Clement, do you know? It might have been through the JCL. I don't know.
Yeah. I mean, I think collections are always a very interesting situation. So, I mean, we even had collections from our collection being moved to UCLA. So it becomes a point of contention. We know the Kitaji Bibles were taken by the Hoover Institute, which, you know, I mean, I think they're a great institution, but it affects access and the ability for others to tell the story. So, and it's something we're working on right now with the Hoover. So, you know, I'm sure it was through the Heart Mountain people that they discovered Estelle's collection. And so they approached her.
Clement brought up the Kitaji Bibles, and maybe some of you know about that, and I'll try and put the link in the chat. But that was a very interesting case where two very extremely heavy, expensive Bibles, which had been illustrated and annotated by an immigrant man in the Poston camp, all of a sudden appeared in private sale in New York for $80,000. And what's interesting is, I think that the eventual rescue of those, and now they're at the Hoover, as Clement mentioned, was, I think, a direct connection to the Rago auction. Because what happened is, number one, these did not go publicly on the market. And number two, somebody who was offered the opportunity to bid on them and purchase them actually emailed me and said, do you know about this? This is like the Rago auction. This is wrong. This was made partially in Poston, Arizona. What do you think? And these two very elaborate Bibles, some of the illustrations have been compared to illuminated manuscripts, because the immigrant man, Captain Kitaji, wrote in extremely fine script and did very elaborate marginalia and drawings. I said, oh gosh, I went to UC Santa Cruz with someone named Kitaji. So contacted them within 3 days. I forget how many, 30 anyway, have written. They said, this is our family object. We just thought somebody had it. And our names are in there because when we were baptized, our names were inscribed in this Bible. We want to get this back. And that's a ridiculous price. So in the end, they were able to negotiate and talk with Swan Galleries, the auctioneer in New York City. And my personal feeling is that they didn't put it on the open market, possibly because they knew that it might attract outrage. And eventually the family did get it back. It's a very interesting story. They negotiated with the Hoover, and the Hoover gave them the ability to keep the digital rights for reproduction of the images, but the physical object is now in a vault. And originally this Bible was found apparently in a recycling bin somewhere. So it's something where that whole story has to be kind of looked into a little bit, but somebody said that they found it and then were putting it up for sale. So it kind of went from this recycling bin to a vault at Stanford. It's another really interesting story, and it's going to be on display at Janum, right, Clement? In a Sutra and Bible exhibition.
Oh, you're muted, Clement. I don't know if that's intentional.
we're hoping, but it's a negotiation. It's
really?
Yeah, it takes a lot of work. We're in the process, so.
And I think there was a question about even like, you know, given what happened with the Eaton collection, has Rego, you know, do they have a new policy in place about artifacts associated with concentration camps? You know, and I think it's even a bigger question of just like, is there policy now? You know, like, are there kind of these like policies and standards with this kind of work? But I know, Nancy, you just mentioned the Swan Company was like, we're just gonna quietly, you know, not put it for public sale because we don't wanna get the backlash, right? Have you seen any kind of formal changes in the selling of artifacts?
In terms of Rego, he was very, elusive and certainly didn't make any formal statement other than to say we didn't realize the extent of, I can't remember the exact words, the harm we were creating, and we certainly need to a conversation needs to take place or something like that. So no, he did not make any kind of promise at all. And I think the community, the auction community, is very concerned because they can see this public outrage occurring. And one of the very beneficial things I think about the Rego auction is that our little upstart committee, and I think people in the community, didn't want prices to be set and then made public, because then that becomes a benchmark for, oh, this is the price of that commodity. This is what a nameplate went for. And in the future, people use that as a basis for further monetizing our history. And so one really positive thing, I think, although, one thing that I think was very good was that appraisers were interested in knowing what was these things going to sell for, and the fact that no price was, the collection was exchanged, but that kind of information wasn't made public, I think was a good thing. We don't want to be Antiques Roadshow.
Yes. and I know I'm kind of overwhelmed on the chat, but if there's anyone who would like to ask their question live, I would like to, you know, open it up for anyone who has questions. As I know that in the chat, there's been questions of just like overall inquiries about confinement sites. Have they been designated as National Historic Sites? Most notably is Manzanar, but I think we've kind of touched on it. They're not all are nationally or, you know, designated, right? Some have chosen not to seek designation and they stay privately owned, and others too are on tribal land, right? So not all of them are seeking this kind of process of federal designation, but I think, you know, you've heard the term Amachi several times now. Omachi and Tule Lake, you know, they're in different parts of assessment to see if they will become designated federally. But I think also Hanauliuli in Hawaii was designated during the end of the Obama administration as a National Historic Site. So there's a lot. I think we shared a lot through the National Park Service of historic sites, and then also through the grants program, the JAX grant program as well. And I think there was a question about just like lesson plans and educational, you know, videos and curriculum for grade school kids regarding not only the Eaton collection, but related work. So is that available online? I think Clement shared some.
Yeah, and I think Mitch Homa and John Tonai are both on this chat too. They're working for they're part of the Amachi Special Resource Study. It's one of the locations. I know George said he was from Amachi. So they are trying to make that a special, give it a national designation. So I don't know, John or Mitch, do you guys have a link to that resource study since it's online now?
Oh, I shared it already. Okay. Yeah. So yeah, and I think they're still in public comment, the stage of receiving public comment. And so if folks want to look at it, it's also very interesting to just see kind of how the sausage is made in these things. Like for Tule Lake, I remember when I was living in Los Angeles, they actually had in-person workshops and charrettes and, you know, interviews about what would people like to see at Tule Lake if it were to become designated as a national site. And so I think they're also doing this with Amachi, and, you know, it's a very interesting process. I think it's something that, you know, it's not always done in the National Park Service. Some of them are executive orders or they're done quietly without much community consultation. So I think it's a larger scale, interesting to see how the National Park Service really tries to work with community to get input on these such designations. And Mitch is saying that the public comment period is open until the end of April. So.
If I can just mention that I think gatherings like this, virtual, of course, are really valuable because otherwise we may not get to have this conversation. But I was also thinking of a in-person Day of Remembrance 2 years ago in De Anza College, which was organized by Tom Izu. And this is not an Eaton artifact, although but it is about this Nisei woman named Amy Iwasaki Mas, and who was a child when she was taken away to Heart Mountain. And we covered this in our 50 Objects project, and the object was a leather bag, which her father had packed by the door, ready to go in case the FBI came to arrest him. He didn't want to disturb his family. She still had that bag. She talked about it in this program with 200 college students. And after the program was over, the moderator said to three young women students who were on the stage afterwards, one was a Pakistani Muslim American, and he said, "What story made the most impact on you?" And she said, "My father's bag." And she said, "Because when my father goes to mosque, I don't know if he'll come back." And then actually 2 weeks later, the Christchurch mosque was attacked. And of course, many people didn't come back. So I think that also shows the power of these objects to connect to issues today. And they can evoke responses that you wouldn't necessarily know about or think about.
Right. No, and I think that's very poignant, Nancy, is I guess my personal story is living here in DC now, and given, you know, political uprisings as of late, I actually have a go bag next to my door in case something were to happen, right? Mm-hmm. And even given the light of the uprising of violence and racial violence against Asian Americans across the United States, how do you know it hits home again for many of us, of like we could be walking, as many of our elders have. They were walking to the subway or walking to the market and were attacked, or walking in Koreatown and have been attacked, right? Not doing anything, you know, out of the ordinary. And so it's still very poignant of at any moment, this kind of, you know, violence that could be inflicted on many of us here in the United States just by what we look like, right? And so I think it's very relevant today. I mean, in this very moment of how we navigate spaces and places based on who we are and our heritage. And so I just want to close out and thank both of you for for sharing such a wealth of not only objects, but experience and knowledge and expertise in the works that you do in telling Japanese American stories, histories, and, you know, heritage in such poignant ways. And so, yeah, I want to just thank everyone. And I thank folks here at University of Maryland for supporting this program, and for each of you for tuning in on your Friday. I know folks are asking for email addresses for Clement and Nancy, as they would like to reach out to you. So if you would like to, if you feel comfortable sharing, you could share it in the chat. And we will also, for everyone who attended today, know there was a lot of links shared. So we will provide a follow-up email with the links that we shared, as well as a link to today's video and last night's lecture presentation with Clement, Nancy, and Shirley-Ann Higuchi. So again, I want to thank everyone today. Stay safe and stay well. And we hope to see you again soon here at the University of Maryland, if it's virtually, or hopefully soon in person. So thank you.